In the wide expanse of Crusader Kings 3, you can play as any baron, duke, king, or emperor within the timeline of both 867 and 1066 AD. This gives you an incredible amount of campaigns at your disposal, and choosing one is a very exciting portion of starting your next grand adventure in Crusader Kings 3. In this video today, I'm going to go through 7 campaigns that are not exactly the best, like the title says, but more really unique or different campaigns than you would have expected or maybe even thought to try out. Only 2 on this list start in Western Europe, in fact, with the rest spread across the map. For the most part, we'll be looking at the historical bookmark of 1066. I do have some 867 starting positions on here, and 2 of the campaigns are flexible in that you can start in either time period if you so wish, but I'll be listing these in order from easiest to hardest as denoted in the lower third that will appear in each section. While all campaigns provide their own individual challenges, some are a bit harder than others. If you'd like to quickly scrub to a specific campaign or see what I have chosen for all 7, you can find chapters within the timeline and a table of contents in the description. And as always, if you decide to pick the game up after watching this, please feel free to use my link in the description. You'll simply receive a Steam key that you'll go ahead and place directly into Steam. But I also get a lovely commission, and as of the creation of this video, there is still, somehow, a 12% discount. This might be the last week of that, I'm not too sure myself, and I'll be changing the link once the sale ends. But let's get started on our list. Number 1 on our list is Great Moravia. Now, this is in 867 AD, so it's a pretty unique starting position because the majority of Eastern Europe, and to the northern portion of this, is still very tribal, is still very pagan. And the nice thing about this starting location is that you have the option to do a holy war on pretty much everyone around you here. This gentleman, this one, over here. So you have a lot of really nice expansion possibilities to the north and the east. In addition to that, you also have a claim to Bohemia right out the gate. So expansion to the west, either as your own personal claim or as your duke's claim, is a great way to expand your territory close to East Francia. And from there, you can actually solidify an alliance so the western portion of your border, A, has support, and B, is not going to become an aggressor. What I also like about this campaign, and why I really rate it as easy, aside from obviously having some really good expansion options, is that your king here, he's not married, and he is 52. So with that being said, you can marry someone who's older and just kind of secure an alliance and not necessarily worry about having kids, because you have a pretty decent heir here in your nephew who is your spy master and already has 3 kids of his own. So this allows you to kind of build your kingdom up in the remaining years of King Ratislav's life before passing over all of your titles to this duke right here. Because when we bring up our realm and go to succession, everything is going to go to him through Confederate partition. So you can really build up as much as you want with your current standing king if you start this campaign and not worry about it all getting broken apart the second that he dies, even though he's the age of 52. Also, you have some pretty cool decisions here to unite the Slavs and unite the West Slavs. So you have some really fun objectives for the mid to late game of this really fun, but also decently accessible and easy campaign. Number 2 in our list is Pratihara, and this is an interesting one because right now you can see it in 867, but there is also a 1066 starting location in Paramara. And the very interesting thing about Indian starting locations is that their development is quite astounding. So if I take a look over here at my kingdom tiles, we'll see that I already have 2 or 3 kingdoms within the lands that I start out with, which is super powerful. But take a look at Pratihara actual. If I switch this over to development, you can see that these things have 20 development. Even moving further to the east, 18, 18, and 18. There are some portions up here that have 18 as well. So what you're taking a look at is large swaths of land that have super high development. Development that matches that of, say, Rome, which has 25, or Constantinople, which has 30 or 35. I can't remember off the top of my head. But having these high development locations allows you to build armies and taxes very quickly to kind of steamroll the opposition. The one big thing about this starting location is that you are surrounded by enemies, so you do have to mobilize quite quickly. And if I open up the interests here, I can see that my realm will lose land when a vassal dies, already showing me that this guy right here is going to pass his title to this gentleman over here in an adjoining nation. So, if you do start this campaign, a great way to get around this is to declare war out the gate on the Habari clan. And I'm going to click a holy war for the county. I'm going to change the objective to the duchy that is going to inherit that land. And I can start that war right out the gate and make sure I solidify that land. I also have a good target to kind of continue wars against and expand my reach to the west into more high development locations. Whether you start this in 867 or the 1066 starting location that I talked about, you'll be dealing with a very different campaign that is a feudal government and that is not a Catholic kingdom. And you're going to be dealing with a lot of development. So you're going to have to really learn a lot about how your domains and holdings work, as well as how these titles are going to pass down to your heir. Because you only have one primary heir, which is nice, and that guy already has two sons. So the Confederate partition should hopefully not be too much of an issue. Your wife is 46, so she's just now at the very end of her possibility of creating more heirs for you. So this is another way to really get acquainted with the game without worrying about Confederate partition smashing apart your kingdom after like 5 or 6 years. Number three on our list goes to Abyssinia. Now you can either start in 867 or in 1066. I've chosen 1066 right now. I find it to be a little bit more stable and an overall better starting location. Now, the nice thing about this is that you play as the Kingdom of Abyssinia, and you are the Coptic religion, which is the furthest south and east Catholic religion in the game. And as thus, you have a couple really strong allies to your southwest in these two nations, and some nice ones to your northwest in these two nations, which make for amazing military allies. And these ones allow you to pretty much quickly either expand into with a marriage alliance or take through the declaration that you have as King of Abyssinia. So if I switch this over to the kingdom titles, you can see that there is a huge amount of land that you have because you are the King of Abyssinia. And because of that, you can actually vassalize some of these people right out the gate. So Shawa, just to our south right here, we can take them just by pressing this and offering vassalage. They'll immediately join our nation and they won't have to actually do a war with them. I think Abyssinia is a really strong nation to start off with because you have the option to expand very freely because all this is holy war territory for the most part. You have a lot of very strong claims to your north right here and to these locations as well. So you can really get a good idea for how you're going to either claim these things through your title or claim them through outright war. And probably one of the strongest things about Abyssinia starting is your succession laws. Looking over succession, you start with partition rather than Confederate partition. The big difference here being that partition is the same thing as Confederate, but without this line right here. New titles may be created for your younger heirs. The nice thing too is that you already have a pretty good son and heir right now. You are unmarried and so is your son, so you can either set yourself up for some really strong alliances or set yourself up for some more heirs, whichever route you want to take with your rulership of Abyssinia. But this is my current campaign that I'm playing and I can't tell you how much I'm enjoying it. You will deal with a lot of tribal raiding, but there's just so much land you can expand into so quickly that you can eventually grow towards this empire title a lot quicker than you would normally in some of the Western European factions. Our next campaign is the Kingdom of Castile. Now you might actually see this one on the campaign selection choice, so this one might be not as completely off the beaten path as normal, but I think it's a really, really cool one, especially when we take a look at these three kings and brothers. And I really like this campaign because one of my favorite historical figures, if I jump to military and I jump to knights, is this gentleman right here. You might know him as El Cid. So I can put him in my army with a whopping 26 martial ability and have a just killer martial right out the gate. I think that that's probably one of my favorite things about Castile. But in addition to that, I jump over here to my decisions. I can unite the Spanish thrones, all three of these, and I can form Portugal. So you have some really cool mid to late game decisions that you can really play around with. And I think that it's really fun with Castile in specific because, again, you're still a feudal nation and you're still a Catholic kingdom. So you're not dealing with too many wild mechanics that you're not used to from the tutorial. But you do have to deal with a lot of aggression from King Philip of France, depending on which one of these brothers you want to attack first. My recommendation to you is if you do start this campaign, go to your court and start finding secrets in the court of one or the other of your brother. And by doing that, you can find a hook, hopefully against them, that you can force them into an alliance to help you attack the other, or to at least negate them from supporting you in attacking the other. This, in my opinion, is the best way to quickly unify all three of these thrones under one banner. Another thing that's really nice about this is that since you are all part of the same dynasty, this is a good campaign to really play around with creating a cadet branch and getting familiar with that system within the dynasty mechanic that was freshly added with Crusader Kings 3. But I find this to be a very action-packed and intense campaign that is really going to test you a little bit more, because this has stepped up a little bit more to a medium difficulty, because you have so much opposition around you that is also very powerful, versus some of the other campaigns where you did have opposition and they were a lot easier to take care of. So hopefully this one will actually put your skills a little bit more to the test. Number 5 brings us far to the east once more in the era of 1066. This does have an 867 starting position, but for this video we're at the 1066 for the Great Liao. Now, for those of you that are a fan of history, you probably know where I'm going with this, but this massive chunk of land is very important. And on top of it, it leads to a very interesting campaign. So if I pop on over here to decisions, you can see that you can become the greatest of Khans. And when you do this, you become the Mongol Empire. And from the Mongol Empire, you get a special invasion casus belli. Now, this makes for an extremely, extremely, not necessarily difficult, but exciting campaign that is going to push you to all corners of the map, depending on how fast and quick you want to expand. You also have to take into consideration that you can really go wherever you want. This casus belli allows you to target an entire kingdom at once and allows for rapid expansion across large swaths of land, as it doth say. So I don't have a whole ton of things to say about this campaign outside of the fact that it's going to be very action-packed in ways that all the other ones differ. You do have the capability to declare war on 12 different locations around you, so even before you jump into becoming the Mongol Empire, you do have a lot of choices to just jump into war. So you can see that this is really a build-your-own-adventure style of campaign, rather than taking a specific set path of, say, maybe the Lord of Ganges, like we were talking about earlier down here with Paramara. With this location, with Great Liao, you can go wherever you want as the Mongol Empire. Do you want to exactly recreate the Golden Horde, or do you want to do something entirely different? So this is a very fun and interesting campaign once you get a better feel for it, because I would definitely chalk this up to a medium difficulty, but really the sky's the limit on where you want to expand on the map with Great Liao. One thing I will say, though, as a word of caution, I have marked this as a hard campaign because it is a tribal kingdom. It's not the standard feudal kingdom that we know and love on the Western Europe end of the spectrum. So this does make for a bit of a challenge. And if you do decide to do this campaign, my advice to you would be to reform your religion as fast as possible. That typically helps in adopting feudal ways quickly. Also, you want to get to absolute tribal authority as fast as possible as well. These things are really crucial in making sure you can make that transition, because a feudal government tends to be a little bit easier to manage than a tribal one. But the advantage of a tribal one is that you can obviously do plenty more on the campaign map with raiding. Number 6 and second to last is Xinjia, or as you might know, Western Xia, if we're taking a look at its historical name. And this one's pretty crazy because you have a very interesting starting position here. Again, you're right below Great Liao, and you've got no natural enemies to your north because of this impassable terrain, and none to your east because of this impassable terrain. But you do have plenty to your south. You can also actually do a vassalization right out the gate right here, so you can expand your territory west on day one of your campaign. But an interesting thing here is that you start off with intelligent as a congenital trait. What the really important thing for congenital traits is, it gives you the ability to really bolster your dynasty. And you want to spend as much time ensuring that congenital traits make their way into your dynasty to ensure that your heirs come out as these hugely diplomatic martial steward intrigue learning badasses. So having a congenital trait to start off with is a very powerful tool, because it makes it so that you can choose pretty much any spouse you want, unless you want to have her also having a congenital trait. I find this to be a very cool addition to your starting position. But I've also marked this as a hard starting location because it's kind of deceptive. Your land has a lot of impassable terrain within it, as you can see. And on top of it, if I switch this over to its development stage, the majority of it is all three development. So you're going to be spending a lot of time bolstering your development to get more levies and to get more taxes. And on top of it, you're dealing with a situation where you can expand to the south. You do have those options through the wars that you can create, but you're going to spend a lot of time trying to create and fabricate claims. You don't have as many holy wars you can jump into, not as much of a clear set path of expansion as you do with a lot of other nations. So while Western Gia is very fun and different, you will have to kind of carve a path for yourself, really forcing a certain direction for the growth that you have in mind for this campaign. Number 7 on our list is unique, because this is the only one where you are not some overarching liege. In fact, we're taking a look at Vermandois right here. Count Herbert of Vermandois is the last of the Carlings. This is the end of the dynasty of Charlemagne. And this is super important here because you can have a lot of fun with this campaign. It's extremely difficult because you are a mere count and you have a liege above you. You have all these other situations you have to deal with. So this is not an easy campaign. That's why this is the very last one we're talking about. You're going to have to spend a lot of time doing intrigue and politics, marrying into claims and fabricating claims and getting as much as you can to recreate the Holy Roman Empire of old. I think this is a really fun kind of role play style campaign that puts you back into the driver's seat of, well, like I said, the last of the Carlings. So with this, you get a very difficult campaign in ways that are different than some of the other ones we've talked about before, because we've always talked about being the king of some land, or maybe if you're the duke of a land and you don't have any lieges above you, that makes for a much easier situation. This time, as Count Herbert, you are the vassal of King Philip of France. So this should be different. It's not like starting as Normandy when you go and claim all of England for yourself and become your own king. Nay, you're just a lowly count over here in Vermandois trying to create the land that you want. So if you want a campaign that's really going to put you against all the things you've learned so far and you want a really cool kind of role play scenario to go with, I think this is definitely going to be the one for you. It's really going to press a lot of your skills and it's going to really force you to think outside of the box of the standard progression of play you're used to as playing maybe a singular duke or a king.